Hello everyone, how are you all? I hope you are doing well. So I welcome you again to your psychology class, and we are doing chapter number 1, that is what is psychology. This is part 3 of this chapter, and if you have not seen the previous parts, you can check the link in the description box. In this part, we will study about evolution of psychology. Psychology as a modern discipline, which is influenced to a large extent by Western developments, has a short history, and it grew out of ancient philosophy concerned with questions of psychological significance. Now, the question that arises here is that what makes psychology different from philosophy? While early philosophers, they relied on methods such as observation and logic, today's psychologists, they utilize scientific methodologies to study and draw conclusions about human thought and behavior. Psychology emerged as a separate discipline during the mid-18th century when a German physiologist named Wilhelm Wundt used scientific research methods to investigate reaction times. His book published in 1874, that is Principles of Physiological Psychology, outlined many of the major connections between the science of physiology and the study of human thought and behavior. He later opened the world's first psychology lab in 1879 at the University of Leipzig. This event is generally considered the official start of psychology as a separate and distinct scientific discipline. So, structuralism was the first school of psychology that came into being. And before moving forward, I would like to tell you the meaning of schools of psychology. It is basically a group of psychologists having similar point of views and making similar approaches to study the human mind or behavior. So, the structuralism was the first school of psychology that was founded by Wilhelm Wundt. Actually, Edward B. Titchener was also strongly associated with this school of thought. And Wundt was interested in the study of conscious experience, and he wanted to analyze the constituents or the building blocks of the mind. Psychologists during Wundt's time analyzed the structure of the mind through introspection method and therefore were called structuralists. Actually, introspection method was a procedure in which individuals or subjects in the psychological experiments were asked to describe in detail their own mental processes or experiences. However, introspection as a method did not satisfy many other psychologists because it was too subjective in nature. And it was considered less scientific because the introspective reports could not be verified by outside observers. As a result, structuralism fell out of favor with the passing of Wundt's student Edward Titchener in 1927. And now the second school of psychology that came into being after the school of structuralism was the school of functionalism. And it was originated as a reaction to the school of structuralism, and it was initiated by William James, an American psychologist who had set up a psychological laboratory in Cambridge, Massachusetts, soon after the setting up of the Leipzig laboratory. William James believed that instead of focusing on the structure of the mind, psychology should instead study what the mind does and how behavior functions in making people deal with their environment. That's why the school was known as functionalism, because it focused on the function of mind. And a very influential educational thinker, John Dewey, was also associated with the school of functionalism, and he used functionalism to argue that human beings seek to function effectively by adapting to their environment. After the school of functionalism, the third school that came into being was Gestalt psychology, which emerged in Germany as a reaction to the structuralism of Wundt. Actually, the word Gestalt means form, pattern, or whole. Gestalt psychologists believed that psychology should study human experience as a whole and not in terms of separate elements. The slogan of Gestalt psychologists was that the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. It conveyed the idea that meaning is often lost when psychological events are broken down. And you will study more about it in chapter number 5. So, while Wundt was interested in breaking down psychological matters into their smallest possible parts, the Gestalt psychologists, they were instead interested in looking at the totality of the mind and behavior. Actually, the development of this school of psychology was influenced by a number of psychologists, but the three main psychologists who were associated with this school of thought were Max Wertheimer, Wolfgang Kohler, and Kurt Kofka. Another reaction to structuralism came in the form of behaviorism, and this school of psychology was based upon the work of thinkers such as John B. Watson, Ivan Pavlov, and B.F. Skinner. John Watson rejected the ideas of mind and consciousness as subject matters of psychology, and he was greatly influenced by the work of psychologists like Ivan P. Pavlov on classical conditioning. For Watson, mind is not observable and introspection is subjective because it cannot be verified by another observer. Behaviorism suggests that all behavior can be explained by environmental causes rather than by internal forces. And behaviorism is focused on observable behavior, means the behavior that can be observed in the real life setting. Theories of learning, including classical conditioning and operant conditioning, were the focus of a great deal of research. Watson defined psychology as a study of behavior or a response to a stimuli, which can be measured and studied objectively. Behaviorism of Watson was further developed by many influential psychologists who are known as behaviorists. Most prominent among them was Skinner, who applied behaviorism to a wide range of situations and popularized the approach. The behavioral school of psychology had a significant influence on the course of psychology, and many of the ideas and techniques that emerged from this school of thought are still widely used today, like behavioral training, token economies, aversion therapy, and so on. Now, the next school of psychology is psychoanalysis. Although behaviorists dominated the field of psychology for several decades after Watson, a number of other approaches and views about psychology and its subject matter were developing around the same time. And one person who shook the world with his radical view of human nature was Sigmund Freud. Sigmund Freud changed the face of psychology in a dramatic way by proposing a theory of personality that emphasized the importance of the unconscious mind. He viewed human behavior as a dynamic manifestation of unconscious desires and conflicts. Freud's clinical work with patients suffering from hysteria and other ailments led him to believe that early childhood experiences and unconscious impulses contributed to the development of adult personality and behavior. In his book, The Psychopathology of Everyday Life, Freud explained how these unconscious thoughts and impulses are expressed often through slips of the tongue and dreams. According to Freud, psychological disorders are the result of these unconscious conflicts. The psychoanalytic theory proposed by Sigmund Freud had a tremendous impact on 20th century thought, influencing the mental health field as well as other areas including art, literature, and popular culture. While many of his ideas are viewed with doubt today, but his influence on psychology is undeniable. Some other psychoanalytic thinkers of psychoanalysis apart from Freud include Anna Freud, Carl Jung, and Erik Erikson. Now, the next school of psychology is humanistic psychology. While the first half of the 20th century was dominated by psychoanalysis and behaviorism, a new school of thought known as humanistic psychology emerged during the second half of the century. American psychologist Carl Rogers is often considered to be the one of the founders of this school of thought. While psychoanalysts looked at the unconscious impulses and behaviorists focused on environmental causes, Rogers believed strongly in the power of free will and self-determination. Psychologist Abraham Maslow also contributed to humanistic psychology with his famous hierarchy of needs theory of human motivation that you will do later in coming chapters. This theory suggested that people were motivated by increasingly complex needs. Once the most basic needs are fulfilled, people then become motivated to pursue higher level of needs. The next school of psychology is cognitive psychology. Actually, the aspects of Gestalt approach and structuralism were combined and led to the development of cognitive psychology, which focuses on how we know about the world. According to the American Psychological Association, that is APA, cognitive psychology is the study of higher mental processes such as attention, language use, memory, perception, problem solving, and thinking. As a scientific study of mind and mental functioning, the core focus of modern cognitive psychology is on studying how people acquire, process, and store information within the complex computing system known as the human brain. Therefore, cognitive psychologists are most concerned with studying how we think, perceive, remember, forget, solve problems, focus, and learn. Whereas the behavioral school of thought that focuses only on observable behaviors, cognitive psychology studies internal mental states and processes. One particularly famous cognitive psychologist is Jean Piaget. Piaget was one of the first psychologists to study cognitive development in a systematic way. While most of his research focused on children, many of his ideas applied to adults as well. According to Piaget, children actively construct their own minds. Another Russian psychologist, Vygotsky, went even further to suggest that the human mind develops through social and cultural processes. So modern cognitive psychology views human beings as actively constructing their minds through their exploration into the physical and social world. That's why this view is sometimes called constructivism. So this is all about the schools of psychology, and I hope everything is clear to you. And we will meet once again in the next part of this chapter, in which we will study about development of psychology in India and branches of psychology. Till then, take care, stay home, stay safe. Thank you.